Good evening, Keene. Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you for joining us tonight. Hello, and thank you for joining us tonight.
I think a private institution would do a much better job.
I don't think that I need to ask permission to drive on the road.
For me, my goal is to live a free life.
So you need to ask for permission to drive on the road.
Go inside, you'll be arrested.
Good evening, Keene. Thanks for tuning in to Free Keene TV. I'm your anchor, Heike Corser. Tonight, we start out with an update. Jay Noon of Bonsville, Massachusetts, was featured in the first episode of Free Keene TV. He refused to pay property taxes for his property and residence. The city threatened to take the property, a threat they have not made good on until now, 5 months later. Jay Noon has had his house seized by city officials and police roughly 2 weeks ago. The city is demanding $35,000 in back taxes. Ian Freeman was arrested at a city council meeting for drinking out of a brown bottle last summer. His charges were recently dropped, and he is now seeking an apology from Mayor Dale Pregent and Police Chief Ken Miola. Here is a video from Tally TV.
I was arrested with some other activists over a year ago at a city council meeting for having a brown bottle which had water in it. We were doing a protest about the open container ordinance in town, and it was a silent protest, so we were sitting there. We had these rules that we were playing by. It was a drinking game that we were doing. And so they don't like fun happening at their meetings, so they decided to arrest us. I was charged with disorderly conduct. Well, about a couple weeks ago, they dropped the charge, so it's not going to trial. It's done. And, of course, that's because they had no case. I mean, they were arresting a peaceful, silent protest, basically, is what they were doing, targeting and arresting us. They don't like the message. Rather than suing them, because I don't feel like that's right. I feel like that's continuing the cycle of violence, and I know a lot of people disagree with that, and that's great for them. They can go ahead and sue the state if that's what they think is a good tactic. But I'd rather have an apology and a what they call a proclamation. The city council frequently issues these proclamations where they pat each other on the back and, you know, give each other awards and make statements that they think are important. So I want them to proclaim something. So I've got my request here, and I tell them about that, you know, my right to protest was violated by Dale Pregent, that's the man calling himself the mayor, and also the Keene Police Chief, Ken Miola. My friends and I were engaging in a silent protest of the open container ordinance, which I just explained, and so I kind of run that down, and I said that I was arrested illegally because I was refused to consent to a search of my property or leave the ostensibly public meeting, neither of which am I obligated to do. The charges in this matter have been dropped by the Superior Court, as they likely recognize there's no case here and I've been wrongfully persecuted. I would appreciate a written apology from both Dale Pregent and Ken Miola, acknowledging they were wrong for stopping the meeting to threaten the peaceful protesters and having us arrested. I would also like a proclamation by the full City Council that from now on, peaceful, silent protests at City Council meetings will be left unmolested. The ultimate question would be to test it out again and see, you know, have folks bring their beverage of choice, you know, and whether it's in a brown bottle or whatever, and have another, you know, drinking game and see if they're safe. I mean, they were safe the second time. 2 weeks after the initial arrest, where three people were arrested, there were maybe four people playing the drinking game. The second time, there was about a dozen people. Well, it's not illegal to drink from a brown bottle in the meeting. There's no crime there. I mean, that's not even open container. Open container has to do with alcohol. I wasn't drunk, and I didn't have alcohol on my breath. There was no staggering or, you know, he had no probable cause to believe that what I had indeed was an open container of alcohol.
On our discussion panel tonight, we have Johnny Ray and Allie Havens. Allie, Jay Noon called the tax bill an extortion fee. Is this appropriate?
I would say definitely, because, I mean, he probably called it that. That's probably why he didn't pay it. And the city was true to their threat. Well, extortion, you don't actually even have to use violence in order for it to be extortion. All you have to do is to tell someone, I'm going to need this much money, or I'm going to break your legs, or I'm going to steal from you, or I'm going to hurt you, or whatever it is. So, basically, they told him that it was $35,000, or they're going to steal his house from him, and He decided to, he had the courage to say no, and they took his house. So he's having to deal with that now. So I definitely say it falls under the definition of extortion.
Yeah. When it comes to some of the language we use, it's a lot of criminal things like extortion, you know, use terms like protection racket. And the only difference are taxation being theft. Mm-hmm. The only difference being that the people doing taxation were elected by a minority, and they just we just sort of changed the words around, but really the effect is the same.
Right, and I think most people just sort of put up with it. They pony up, or they, you know, just sort of go along with it because they think that they think if they don't, then we're going to let some bad people slip away. But, you know, what do you owe the city for? What do you owe the city for owning a home?
Allie, do you think Ian will get an apology from the city?
No, I really doubt that. That doesn't seem very like the city to just issue apologies.
Well, other than suing the city, what can an individual do to hold the city accountable?
I think suing them is, you know, is one way, and but other than that, I really just think that sort of trying to live free and videotaping it and seeing what happens and exposing that to people is sort of, you know, they say the court of public opinion is sort of allows people to sort of see what the threat is behind, you know, all the demands they make of people, and it sort of lets people have a reason to oppose it, because it's not just, oh, we're just asking this of you. It's not too much to ask, because then it's like, well, if I don't do that, then look what happens. It's an overwhelming use of force, and this is not right. So I think it's easier to show people that what the state asks is not right, because everything the state asks of you is backed up by this use of a gun or stealing, or, you know, just having, forcing you to go to their court, or you just have to go along with more stuff if you ever decide to, you know, you don't want to do that because you're independent.
Thank you, Allie. Heike.
Thank you, Johnny and Allie. For our next video, we turn to CopLock and Ademo Freeman.
Hey, everybody, it's Ademo with CopLock.org. Today I found out via the union leader that I've been indicted on 3 felony wiretapping charges out of Manchester, New Hampshire. Before I get into those, I'd like to give you a little history on how these charges came about. On October 3rd, there was an incident at West Manchester High School. A student there, Frank, was involved in an interaction with a police officer, Darren Murphy. Another student, Michael, decided to film the interaction because about a week prior, he had received a DVD from myself and Pete highlighting CopLock.org videos. That night, Mike and Frank came to Pete and I and showed us the video. I shot a short interview with them and published a video online. To round it off, I also made a phone call to the Manchester Police Department and the high school itself. Fast forward a couple months later, Frank has gone through expulsion processes. Michael has been targeted with more police interactions due to a fight between him and another teenager. And now I am facing 3 felony wiretapping charges. In my opinion, this is just an attempt to hide from the lack of accountability. Officer Murphy never missed a day of work. The high school has gone on to ban CopLock.org from being viewed on its computers, as well as any swag or t-shirts on its property. To my knowledge, Darren Murphy has yet to face any punishment at all, as well as any faculty who were shown in the video encouraging Michael to delete evidence of a possible crime.
I had tried to walk away, and I was harassed by multiple teachers and the principal. They immediately tried to make me give them the information, give them the video, and they tried to retrieve my personal belongings to steal basically the information and delete it so that there could be no evidence. And I kind of snaked my way around it by telling them that I only had a couple pictures. They forced me to delete those pictures. However, I still have the video evidence.
Once again, I'll be forced to defend myself from accusations that have harmed nobody. If you look at the overall incident, only one man used force and actually harmed another one. Yet everyone else who is peaceful is being criminalized by the state. Those accusing me of this crime are sending a message that those who use force to get their way are right, and those of us who ask questions and seek accountability are wrong. I think this goes to show just how sad the justice system is. instead of looking at everyone individually and justice being blind, the system has protected its own and criminalized those who are trying to hold them accountable. If you believe that information should be free and that public officials' actions are transparent, call the Manchester Police Department or the Hillsborough's District Attorney's Office. Let them know your thoughts. Stay tuned for more at copblock.org.
On the job equals on the record. Is that right, Allie?
I would say so, especially if you're working for the people. If you're supposed to be a public servant, then the idea would be that I don't see why you wouldn't, you know, if you're working at a job, even when I work, I don't have people coming in with cameras or anything, but I don't assume that no one's going to have a camera. I always try to act, you know, as I think that would be responsible and appropriate for me to act in my job. So I'm not really too worried about cameras where I work. So I don't understand why. Well, I do understand. The police are worried about cameras because they're sort of used to being able to do things without really being watched too carefully. So especially in schools where the children are told that they don't have rights, it's especially hard when a student has a camera. And I remember there's this whole thing on the news with kids filming their teachers and, you know, putting on YouTube and everything. And they did, and I know most schools now, they don't even allow cameras or phones or anything with a camera because, you know, they don't want parents to know what happens behind the doors of the school. All they want them to know is what they tell them at parent-teacher meetings.
Mm-hmm. It reminds me a little bit of the Bart incident, where after the police officer killed the young man on the subway platform, then the police fanned out through the crowd, plucking cameras confiscating all the recording material that anybody had. And it was somebody who was on a train that was pulling away from the station.
Mm-hmm.
That's able to
capture that?
Yeah, the video that I saw. So the school, the police, they're okay with this, I guess. Does that say something about America or the world or city?
I think it sort of highlights this problem that parents are having with being responsible for their kids and wanting to know what's... It seems like a lot of parents sort of drop their kids off, say, you know, goodbye, Johnny, and then they leave, and then they, you know, pick them up or have them dropped off by the school at their homes, and then, you know, nothing ever, you know, what'd you learn today? But there's no, were you treated like a person today? Were your rights respected? Or I can't, you know, there's not really that. They have this idea that they go there and they're taught things and they're made a better person and they leave. But while there are good teachers that can teach, that can broaden your horizons and make you think about a subject differently, the most of what going to public schools is about is being to class right on time, or having to go to detention. You know, just going by all their rules, being where they tell you to be or not wearing the things that are not school appropriate, limiting speech. Trying to drug test students, just like every little piece of rights that students already, you know, are limited to, they're trying to slowly take those away. And I don't think there's enough of a concern from parents about, you know, the rights that their students have, because they're people too. Just because they're younger doesn't mean that they're not.
Yeah. Parents seem to me to have a faith in public schooling that... As a longtime student, I never built that faith. Maybe a handful of teachers were, I can think of one who was fantastic. I can think of stretches of hours gone by in school of boredom and non-engagement mm-hmm. and terrible disappointment. I would have been better probably if I had been sent to a coal mine or something for
yeah.
for 8 years rather than the schooling that I got.
Well, at least you'd be getting paid for your time, right? I always thought it was, I remember in school having to go to school and having a job at the same time and loving going to work and thinking, wow, I get paid to be at work and I'm forced to be at school for 8 hours and I don't even get paid for it and I'm doing all this work that I don't want to do. You know, it's just, and on top of that, having all my rights infringed upon, I think it's really sad that they try to make school into this thing where you get to learn about the democratic process and you get to learn what our country's about, but what is it actually teaching our future? They say that our kids are the future, which, you know, makes sense. It's what's going to happen. Our people who are kids who are in school now are going to be the adults of later. And if they're being taught that people don't have rights, or at least when they're children and their brains are being developed, that rights don't apply to them, then how are they going to react when they grow up? You know, I think that's largely responsible for the way people act now, because that's how they're treated when they're children. And it's only getting worse from what I can tell.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's like we were talking about off the air last week. It kind of goes backwards and forwards, mirror images. Jail is like detention.
Right.
ISS is what they called it at Asheville High.
That's what we called it at our school,
in
too.
In school suspension.
Right. And something that I thought was really, you know, I liked how Ademo pointed out that while, you know, there's this video, which is the objective evidence, that is what happened on the day, and this is what all these, you know, his, that's what he's, like, going to be his,
His three felonies
are about, and the kid's been dismissed from school,
mm-hmm.
and you know, these are the people that are being punished from the situation, and by the video, the only one that seemed to be acting aggressively was the police officer.
Absolutely. Heike.
Thank you. Our next video comes from Derek J. Freeman and Freeman TV. Derek went to the first General Assembly of the Occupy New Hampshire movement and interviewed participants.
My name is Elizabeth.
My name is Benazoglio.
I am Cecilia.
Andre Nott.
My name is Ryan Hirsch.
Mark Provost.
Rick Dirk, that's right.
Okay. Yeah.
My name is Phil. I'm from Australia.
My name is Shannon Thompson, and we are in Hooksett, New Hampshire.
Occupy New Hampshire had a statewide General Assembly today, and this location was offered up by an Occupy member who works for the AFL-CIO. And since the occupation in Manchester was kicked out of the park by the police, we've splintered, and people have gone back to their hometowns and started up their own General Assemblies. So this was trying to get everybody back together again so that we can plan for bigger and better things. Personally, I would like to see the Occupy movement end the wars. I would hope that we can stop killing people and then worry about other issues.
I have been working with Occupy Manchester for a while, and I am hoping to get the organization throughout the whole state and really within the whole country and hopefully the world all headed in the right direction. And I think the first step to do that is really communicating. I think that's the strength of Occupy, so you have to come out to do it.
And we're in Hooksett here. We're at the AFL Plumbers and Steamfitters Hall on a Londonderry Turnpike. What brought me out here today is the same reason I've been doing this for a couple months, involved in the Occupy movement. It's, you know, the corporate domination of our political system and our economic system has led to a unprecedented economic and political crisis. The 1% have far too much power and influence over the laws of this country, and I think most of the time it works to the detriment of you know, working families and the 99%.
I wanted to get even with the 1% and non-violent. So what I did, I wrote 1% in every letter, in every paper of this tissue paper here. All this That's a 1%, 1%. So each time I go,
students, staff,
I reduce them to this. White work.
What I've done is we've got a show in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. It is Occupy Radio Portsmouth, and we're looking to model ourselves after the encampments that have been going on around the country. So we're encouraging other community radio stations, nonprofit citizen radio stations, to also start their own Occupy radio shows.
We are kind of at a gathering of different Occupy organizations to just kind of discuss what we would like to do, what we think we might be able to accomplish in the coming months, especially with primaries coming up, and we're just really working on our organization.
We're in Hooksett, New Hampshire. Well, I've been doing a show called New Hampshire Events for years, every week. I cover the presidential primary, and I've been covering this since 1996. I came to the conclusion about 2 years ago that there was no one that I wanted to vote for. There was no one in the future I wanted to vote for. I was born in 1939, and I had never worried about the middle class through the 40s, through the 50s, and 60s, 70s. But about 2 years ago, when the Tea Party came into fruition, I began to really worry about it. And the middle class was just shrinking down rapidly. And very rapidly, and for the first time ever in my life, I began to worry about the middle class ending. I have nothing against the wealthy people, or they could, you know, nothing against the poor people, but the middle class is what America is all about. I was really worried about it. When the Occupy movement arrived in New Hampshire, I went to the first meeting. They're not backing a candidate. That is a main issue with me. the democracy of it. And the democracy is terrible to do. Today was an example of it. A whole bunch of people trying to come to certain resolutions on certain problems and still staying very democratic. And that is very difficult to do. We were doing what Thomas Jefferson did, and it is frustrating. It is sloppy. It is just so tedious, but it is great.
I've just been attending the statewide conference, or first statewide GA for New Hampshire. I was really impressed. I thought consensus was actually reached in a fairly fluid manner. There are a lot of viewpoints expressed. I was pleased to be able to participate in it as well as film it. So I thought it was a very positive experience and possibly set the groundwork for future actions and future conferences to be held and general assemblies to be held. My favorite issue. Okay. Massive economic inequality leading to complete domination of the political, social, media, economic, and all other spheres on the planet that we're desperately trying to call attention to and modify.
Everyone here is here on a voluntary basis. I mean, if you disagree with something here, feel free to voice it. I do. If I don't agree with something, I'm not going to go through with it, and I'm going to let people know that I disagree. And I'm actually one of the people who mic-checked Obama. I signed on knowing full well that I could actually be arrested. I have no police record. And I really, really was conflicted with giving that away and actually having a police record for something. But it was just something that was such an important message that I wanted to get out there.
Okay, Ryan, 10-second pitch of your favorite pet issue.
I don't even need 10 seconds. Apathy.
Hmm. Allie, all of us have heard a lot about the occupiers here, there, all across the country. Democracy is a word that they like to use a lot. What are your feelings about democracy? Do you feel good about it? Do you feel bad about it? Do you feel sometimes good, sometimes bad?
I guess it depends. Sometimes good, sometimes bad. Because the good feelings associated with the word democracy that I feel are that it shows that someone is trying to, if someone's really in democracy, to me, it tells me that person really wants to do what's best for you know, for as many people as possible. What things can we do and have input from as many people as possible in order to achieve the best outcome so that everyone can be happy, or at least most people can be happy. But I don't think that works. I don't think that's a job for government. I don't think it's good to give a bunch of people the legitimate use of guns and then say, okay, now you're in charge of, you know, holding meetings and deciding what's best for everyone, and we'll elect you and do our democratic process, because it's gonna be corrupted and, you know, they're going to misuse it. And even if they were able to figure out how every person, every taxpayer felt about an issue and sort of persecute those that are not doing something that a majority of people don't like, you know, where you and I might decide that we don't like that Heike wears green. So in a democracy, if we're the people that make up the society, then we can take Heike's shirt from her, and there's nothing she can do about it. And under the guise of democracy, that's totally okay. Mm-hmm. But under, you know, self-preservation and, you know, individual rights, that's not okay, because Heike has a right to wear whatever she wants.
Yeah. Heike.
Thank you for watching tonight. We leave you with a final video promoting a dance competition that our technical director is part of. As always, tune in every Monday at 7 p.m. for the latest episode of Free Keene TV. I'm Heike Corser saying goodnight, Keene.